What happens when two bass road warriors spend quality time talking music and life with one of their peers? Find out every Monday at 8 on Notes from an Artist. Bassist, educator, author David C. Gross, and bassist and head honcho of KnowYourBassPlayer.com, Tom Semioli, trade eights with the legends of rock, jazz, funk, blues, folk, country, and more. Notes from an Artist. Revealing conversations with the legends who've created the soundtrack of our lives. Every Monday at 8 on CygnusRadio.com. And check out previous episodes on our podcast. Notes from an Artist.buzzsprout.com.
This is a great interview. Obviously, and you'll hear in the interview how much of a fan I was of Spirit. And the bass playing on that record was incredible. What I did not know, which we will listen to in this interview, is that Fresh Garbage really was inspired, or Jay Ferguson was inspired by Grazing in the Grass. And not the bass line, the melody. And I do play that song within this, and just blew my mind. What do you think?
That was a fine, well, many nuggets of information from Mark Andes. Really, this guy, a sweetheart of a man, a gentleman, one of rock and roll's great gentlemen, was a rock and roll zealot. I mean, he was everywhere. He was an early member of Canned Heat. He never got to record with them. A founding member of Spirit. And David explained to the audience how important Spirit was, melding jazz, rock, folk, blues, psychedelia, and early prog.
What's interesting is how little success they had until their fourth record. They were brilliant musicians. I actually saw them at the Fillmore. And I mentioned within the piece that I actually bought the first Pink Floyd album and the Spirit album the same day at Macy's Herald Square. And to think about, here were two really incredible, really different, and really original bands. Pink Floyd went on to such massive success, yet Spirit was pretty well a cult item, even with the success of Nature's Way.
Right. And then from Spirit, he goes to Jo Gunne with Jay Ferguson and his brother, Matt Andes. Mark will talk about what a musical family he came from. And his father was a Hollywood actor. Then if Jo Gunne wasn't enough for a few records, he goes on to Firefall, where they have that big hit in the mid 70s. You Are the Woman, sort of a country rock, soft rock hit. And then that's not enough, David. He becomes a member of Heart. He replaces original bassist Steve Fossen in 1983. In 1985, they have the big hits, These Dreams, What About Love, The Big Hair, The Big Video.
He certainly did. Good-looking guy, really a fine bass player, and did a lot of other things. He was on a Kim Carnes record. He was on an Escovedo record. Played with the Bump Band with Ian McLagan. I play a couple of those tunes within this thing. So it's not just Spirit, Heart, and Firefall. And speaking of Firefall, they just came out with a new record called Comet, and they do a version of Nature's Way.
Right, and he duets with Timothy B. Schmidt of the Eagles and Poco. Just great reflections on L.A. in the 60s, the album format, playing with the great Cassidy.
Yeah, right.
Drums, and of course, Stairway to Taurus.
Yeah, well, you know, we could talk about this forever. But towards the end of the interview, I do a mashup of Taurus into Stairway and Stairway to Heaven. And folks, as I say in the broadcast, make your own decision. But I put these two songs together. They're in the same key. They're in the same tempo. I'm sorry. As Tom once said, Led Zeppelin had better lawyers. And on that note, I think you're going to love this interview. Let's get started. Here's Mark Andes.
There he is. Hey, Mark, how you doing?
Hey, man. How you doing?
Okay, you got David up there in your left-hand corner?
I do. Hey, David.
Yeah, I'm not too heavy.
We're worried about that. I'm sorry.
Well, good to see you again, Mark. We last met in 1999 when I was a lot skinnier, and you were working with Kelly Willis, and I was working with Joan Myers.
Oh, get out. Wow.
Yeah. And
she's the best.
Say that on film so we can send it to her.
Joan Myers is the best.
No further questions, Your Honor. Well, and it was a matter of fact, I remember you did a performance at, I guess it was Roseland. It was some sort of CMT event. And I'm sitting next to Russ Teitelman, of all people, David. And Russ Teitelman whispers in my ear, he goes, isn't that Mark Andes of Spirit? And I said, son of a gun, it is. Anyway, let's start. Let's go backwards. Let's talk about the new record, Comet.
Okay.
What prompted Firefall to make another record in the 21st century?
Well, you know, I think that we started to broaden our repertoire to include some of the family roots of the band. And we decided that we should try to do songs like Nature's Way, Got a Line, right. So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star. And they got such a good response that the idea came up that we would record maybe a handful of songs, like maybe even a live thing, you know,
right, sure.
And incrementally sort of release them and as pieces of merchandise. I mean, literally. So we're looking to really just try to have more stuff to sell at gigs. And that's the humbleness of the approach. And the first song we cut was Nature's Way.
That was Firefall doing Nature's Way. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
We had been doing it. It got a great response. All of the family tree songs, which would be Nature's Way, Got a Line, and So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star, got huge responses appropriately. And so it went from there. I don't know how it got decided that we would make a full 10 song CD rather than 3 to 5 songs at a time, which I was in favor of, instead, you know, to kind of pull it out and kind of not have the pressure of really coming up with a 10 song record. But it took us 4 years to actually get good enough in the studio with this lineup, actually come up with You Here with what You Hear in common. So it was a arduous, very it took a long time, and this was pre-COVID. So we were in Nashville, so we would pop into a Nashville studio. We were in Colorado, we were in Texas. I mean, we sort of did this thing kind of real time, real location stuff, and then it turned into a virtual thing later, because after a while I just said, I have to be honest, I don't know where's this going, how
the White House,
the White House. Okay, I'll be truthful, it came at a certain point where I said, I'm done, this is taking forever. So I said, use Nashville guys if you have to, whatever, I'm done. And to Jock's credit, some of the best work for the record got done with him going outside the box, but the soul of the record is with David and me and or the core group. But I'll tell you, it was not an easy process, for sure.
And for those of our younger viewers, David and Mark, who don't know what an album is, okay, this is what an album looks like, okay? And that's called album artwork. And you know what you could do back in the day, David? You could actually get the artist to autograph
something. Open it up.
Right, and look at that.
Oh. What date?
1999.
That's how I want to party, dude.
That's how we looked in 1999 there, David.
No. That was 68.
So it's 1977. I'm playing the Blue Note in Boulder. And this guy taps me on the shoulder, says, "Hi, I'm Rick. I'm in Firefall." The first thing I said to him, "Where's Mark Andes? I got to talk to him about Fresh Garbage."
That was my favorite tune. It's called Fresh Garbage. And Mark Andes, our guest, was on bass. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
You're too kind.
No, it's true. It really is true. But we had a good time that night after the show. It certainly snows in Boulder.
Oh, yes. Frequently, even in the summer.
That's what I meant. And I had a second almost close encounter with you. Actually, it was a few years away. We were doing the Schaefer Festival. Originally, Emmylou Harris was supposed to be the headliner. And it ended up Hart. It was a very bizarre combination with Aztec Two-Step and Hart. But
so that was in the 70s?
That was 78. So you hadn't joined Hart as yet.
So, correct. But Firefall was opening up quite a few Hart shows. So the kind of the relationship started to evolve from when Firefall was opening for Hart. And then we went to Japan and Hart and Firefall opened up for the Beach Boys. And that's when we really kind of bonded. That's when the horrible kind of, there was a rainstorm outside and it filled up the roof of this little outdoor theater and it crashed down on Hart. And really, it came very close to almost really seriously injuring Mike DeRocher. That's when we bonded. And then it went from there.
Sure, sure.
And what prompted the duet with Tim Schmidt on Nature's Way?
Oh, because I'm so insecure about being lead singer. And I was insecure, to be honest.
Okay, really?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I can sing harmony with Fogelberg. I can do that stuff. But to ask me to sing lead was very challenging and daunting. And I had come back from a Firefall run, and Timothy was doing a solo, not a solo, but a band show, but as a soloist, right? And he had this killer lineup. And I come straggling into town, and Val and I go to the show. And during the show, it occurs to me that maybe the whole idea of doing Nature's Way with Firefall was to pay tribute to Randy.
That was the original version of Nature's Way by Spirit. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
So we had this track, and I knew it was going to be recorded. And I asked Timothy, I said, man, are we going to do this? We got a version of Nature's Way. It's sounding really good. It sounds like Firefall doing Nature's Way. Would you please help me out, sing a verse, then do the harmonies. And Hank Linderman, the musical director of a killer band, said, you better ask McPhee to do something because he will get his feelings hurt. So I asked John, I said, man, are you in? And he said, yes. And so we had these guys guest on Nature's Way, and it turned out to be what you got.
Oh, wow. I mean, and of course, I think between you and Timothy, David, all my gold records from the 70s. I mean, gosh, you look at the lineup of you guys.
I know. It's crazy.
Spirit, Firefall, Jo Gunne, Poco, oh, the Eagles.
Exactly. Fogelberg.
Fogelberg. Let's not forget. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And then, but one of the nice things about the record is it harkens back to the original Firefall sound from 76.
That was Just Remember I Love You, Firefall, with our guest, Mark Andes, on bass. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
And as you remember, in 76, there were no such thing as legacy artists. You had to sound contemporary. So I think that was the plight of many a band trying to keep up with the times, when really all you had to do was be yourself.
That's a good point. And we, I guess, were fortunate in that we couldn't really do much more than what we were putting out there. That was what we were capable of. We were great instrumentalists. We could arrange these wonderful songs that Rick and Larry were writing. But basically, we were functioning at the peak of our capacity. And fortunately, it was resonating with people that really liked that kind of music.
But harkens back. It's the California sound, the harmonies of the Beach Boys,
exactly,
and the Birds. That's really what it was. You took their language and you added to it.
There you go. Yeah, exactly.
And I think a lot of it has to do with, at first, Sweethearts of the Rodeo, mm-hmm, which I think brought everybody into that, oh, we can do this. And, you know, you have Burrito Brothers. You had so many, I guess you'd call it country, folk, rock. It was, you know, a really wonderful time. There were even, well, RCA, which was where we were. The other band that was doing something similar was Pure Prairie League.
Yes,
hit with Amy and such. So it was a really interesting time for that.
You just heard two tracks, one by Aztec Two-Step, Hurting, and the second was Amy, the hit for Pure Prairie League. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
The funny thing is that I left Topanga Canyon in a huff because I'd gotten fired from Jo Gunne, which is how that really came down. So I was in Jo Gunne, got fired from my own band, and said, man, blank this, I'm leaving L.A., I'm going to Colorado.
That was Run, Run, Run by the band Jo Gunne. This is Notes from an Artist, CygnusRadio.com.
I didn't know but one family, the Goranson family in Pete's, Colorado, and showed up on their farm doorstep, and they said, okay, well, we can hook you up. And it took a while to network, but it occurred to me that all of Topanga Canyon, including Neil Young and Stills and all these guys, had left Topanga about the same time I did, and were in Colorado. And I'm like, I left Topanga to get rid of this thing. Yeah, they were haunting me, man.
And Kenny Passarelli, another Coloradan, and I think didn't Skip Batten go out there? I'm not sure. I think he did. But, we talk about the album format, David and I, and I love Comet. It sits well as 10 songs. But I ask you, now, you were the one who said do it in bits and pieces. In the 21st century, is the album format still relevant in a Spotify, Amazon Music world?
Well, I agree. And the whole flow of Comet was mainly kind of was because of our limitations as a band in that lineup. We didn't really have much experience recording in the studio, vocally especially. So it took quite a while to find our groove and our blend, really. And then the whole protracted process, the duration of it, I'm going, oh my God, how long is this going to play out? What are we doing here? But I have to say, in retrospect, for all of my fears, Jock really pulled it out. He really had that very vision that you are describing, which is this continuous sort of, okay, this is Firefall from back in the 70s is recording a new record, and we want it to sound something like that, and he succeeded.
That was way back when, from Firefall's latest CD, Comet. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
But then again, you know, we talk about the age of streaming. I know people of our generation will sit and listen to a whole album as a piece of work. It's a whole different ballgame now, where, yeah, you do kind of almost have to put out singles on streaming platforms to get attention. But you already have a built-in fan base.
Yeah, that's the truth. And Jock's very fortunate to have inherited a brand name like that.
Right.
What I envisioned during this whole time was that humble. I thought, well, let us have something that we can sell at a show, more merchandise. I mean, that was and still is what this is about, really. Mm-hmm. There's no way. When Nature's Way was initially, they called it a release, but we wound up getting played on the radio. But it happened like 4 years earlier, so there was no way to really build on that excitement. So the Firefall thing kind of, I don't know, it was hit and miss, but it seems to be connecting. Mm-hmm. And we're able to play, I mean, the songs that we do play from the record are Way Back When and Nature's Way. That's enough new stuff, you know, to appease the people and kind of lead them into what we're trying to sell them, basically. So that, you know, it's not rocket science, but you have to have content. You know what I'm saying?
And your song. What's that, David?
Good songs.
Exactly. You need a song, don't you? Don't you need a song?
And you do a lovely intro to Way Back When on the video. And it's just, you're absolutely right. The issues that you sang about 50 years ago are still relevant in 2021.
Well, what I love about the whole rollout of songs is the first thing that got released was Nature's Way, which is from 1970. So the whole rollout of the new Firefall record, including the song that Jock wrote, which is so clever, which was Way Back When, referencing all the great songs. The artist. And then we lead off the whole thing with this really retro old school song. Do you know what I'm saying?
It's relevant. It's absolutely relevant.
Exactly. Unbeknownst to us, we had no idea that there would be kind of a concept there.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's so funny too. You know, when you think about Nature's Way and then, well, wait a second. You were talking about that stuff on Fresh Garbage.
Exactly.
You were there way ahead of most folks in terms of environmental awareness. You could say, don't go near the water, the Beach Boys. But that, too, was 71. So that was even 3 years later.
Oh, Fresh Garbage was 67. Yeah, yeah.
And when you think about it, who was thinking about that stuff? I mean, I was going, how do I learn this bass line? Boom, boom.
Exactly. And that, and to give credit where credit is due, that is Jay Ferguson, man. He wrote that bass line.
Okay. Oh,
okay. And do you know what the inspiration was?
Hendrix.
No, Hugh Masekela.
Oh.
And he comes in
grazing in the grass.
That's part of it, but the dissonant vocal melody, that is Hugh Masekela, man. Isn't that interesting? I mean, Jay,
that's fascinating.
I know.
Wow.
We have to go back and play that thing. We have to.
Well, you know, when you think about that song,
that was Hugh Masekela, grazing in the grass. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
And see, I've been stalking you since then because I was at the Fillmore when you guys, and all of a sudden I see, where are these giant drums coming from on either side of Ed Cassidy, right?
Exactly. But
when you think about it, he's walking a bass line like a jazz bass player. So obviously you had to have some education with music, correct?
No, I didn't. I was playing with guys that had a jazz background. And what I was doing early on was sounding like what I thought a jazz bass player would sound like. I was totally mimicking Jimmy Garrison and, you know, I mean, the real, you know, the guys that were really making jazz wonderful back then. But I was unaware of this. I was a rock guy from the San Fernando Valley playing rock instrumentals before surf music was invented, you know.
Right.
So I was way, way back in the gene pool.
That was John Coltrane. Chim Chim Cheree with the great Jimmy Garrison on bass. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
And then Spirit awakens me and Randy and John Locke and Cass are going, oh, no. Tunji, you know, John Coltrane, check this out. You know, Bill Evans.
That was Waltz for Debbie, the great Bill Evans trio with Scott LaFaro on bass and Paul Motion on drums. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
So there for the first maybe 5 years of Spirit, I'm imitating what I consider to be a jazz bass player.
Which is a great way to do it. I mean, in terms of our listeners, if you think about it, if they can accommodate and listen to what is actually going on, you literally can, you can do anything. Who was it, Tom? One of our guys said, I know the notes are on the bass. Which one?
Yes, so that was Greg Chase and said, very, you know, after listening to one of your peers, Mel Schachner, Grand Funk Railroad, held that bass in his hands and he says, I know those lines are in there. I got to get them out of here.
Yep. And I mean, there's some wonderful quotes like there's no wrong notes, you know, just, you know, I mean, it's all there. The wonderful thing that I had going for me was this sort of fearlessness about just playing and not being afraid to be silly or stupid or, you know, blow it. You know, it was, that's why I love Spirit.
That was Dark Eyed Woman from the third Spirit album, Clear Light. This is Notes from an Artist, and let's get back to our interview with bassist Mark Andes.
How did you, I mean, you had your brother Matt, obviously a musician, your dad was an actor, so you certainly grew up in an artistic family. How did you gravitate towards the bass in the first place?
I had a high school band that was really, really good. Mm-hmm. And Matt and I were the guitar players. And the bass player, who was very, very accomplished, Tom Mitchell was his name, got a really good gig and went on. And Tom Bresch and Tom Mitchell wound up playing together and did really well in the country circuit. We had a hole in the lineup and I went to bass. And actually, I saw the Standells play in our little area. And I saw the Standells play and the bass player looked so cool. And I thought, well, God, I could do that. That's how we're kind of out of necessity.
Well, I know someone's going to go, why didn't you play Dirty Water by the Standells? That's because everybody knows Dirty Water by the Standells. I thought, wouldn't it be great to play a different tune, something that most people may not know? This is called Sometimes the Good Guys Don't Wear White. And that was the Standells from the same record that Dirty Water's on. And this is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
Mark, do you know how many people think the Standells are from Boston?
Most of us come to the instrument out of necessity. I think that's
isn't that interesting.
Well, you know, we spoke to some more of your peers, Richard Thompson, John Altman, Leo Lines of 10 Years After, Harvey Brooks, who you must know, and Rick Wills.
I did.
And we were all talking about that period where, you know, the Spirit came into existence and how you blended, you know, jazz, folk, blues, rock. And that it was kind of because the record industry didn't quite know what they were doing in those days. That's so they just put a lot of stuff out. Do you think that could that happen again now that we no longer have a record industry and we have digital distribution?
Yes. The difficult thing is that it's so competitive and there's so many people out there able to do this stuff. Back in the 60s, you had to be signed to a record label. You know, there were all these hurdles to overcome, but it really thinned out the herd. These days, man, it's like everybody that can think about a record can do a record, and it's like wonderful, but holy moly. I mean, you get that many people out there, and then the streaming, I mean, you get maybe a billion streams and you're making maybe $500. I mean, there's no revenue earning potential from having a hit record or a hit streaming thing. So that's why I was really hoping that the Firefall guys would get this record done so that hopefully after the pandemic and we can get out and really play, which might be in jeopardy now as we speak, but you know, at least we would have that moment where the audience, who's basically our generation, is having an experience with a group that is selling a product that is kind of reminiscent.
That was You Are the Woman from the second Firefall album, 1977. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
You want something in your hand.
Exactly. Right? Which is why I was hoping that we would release at least this record. Maybe if it becomes successful, that we would do a vinyl run.
Oh, that'd be fabulous.
I think.
With a gatefold and a poster, please.
What I said in the meeting, our Zoom meeting, I said, we should release this music as we intended it to be heard back in the day. Come on, you know, but it's expensive, you know.
And touring, too, has become so much more expensive now with gas and all everything's gone up. So it changes things. Tom and I were talking earlier about how the quote unquote legacy artists, they've got to work 4 or 5 days a week to really come up with the money.
Yeah.
Right. You have to do at least four. Well, you know, we had an interesting conversation with Ron Carter, another bass player, you know. Oh. And we also had a great we all did the same. And Larry Grenadier. And we're seeing streaming as sort of video streaming as maybe a new platform aside from just plain audio recording and live performance. Larry Grenadier did a beautiful solo bass concert from, what was it, David? The Village of Vanguard.
Yes.
Yeah, which he, you know, they sold tickets and I think you could pay anywhere from $10 up. And of course, the Zombies are doing a live show from Abbey Road, which they're going to stream. Bob Dylan just did a fabulous streaming concert which was especially meant for streaming. As the Zoom technology becomes more sophisticated, what are your thoughts on the idea of, well, it's not the same as performing in front of a live audience, but Zoom concert?
Oh, I'm all in. It's very technically sophisticated, really, really provide an experience that really has that high quality production value. Mm-hmm. We're not there yet, but I'll tell you, I think it's appealing. And those songs where they have people from all over the planet kind of contributing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Where they'll pick a song and there'll be all these artists.
Right. There's a mashup. There's one outlet that does it that combined Robbie Robertson and Chad Smith.
That started out with Ringo asking Robbie Robertson, what key are we in? And that was a mashup, Five Continents, Playing for Change. Musicians from all over the world. And that was The Wait. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
There you go. That kind of thing is so appealing, and it's so inclusive. It helps. It helps the whole cause, you know, performances, live performances, and recording performances. I think that does nothing but help.
That was a record by Alejandro Escovdeo called Take Your Place with Mark Andes on bass. This is Notes from an Artist, CygnusRadio.com.
Why do people call Mark Andes for a session?
Well, not many people these days.
That's because of Pro Tools.
Maybe, you know, but I'm very selective with that stuff. But I recorded for, I don't know, 2 or 3 years here in Houston, pretty exclusively at the Sugar Hill Recording Studios. And man, it was very interesting. And to be a session guy and learn a zillion songs a week and go in 3, 4, 5 times a week. And I live northwest of Houston and I'm going well south of Houston to get to the Sugar Hill Studios. But it was very, very, very good. I just got burned out on it. And
yeah.
I priced myself out of the market, kind of intentionally. But I will do sessions occasionally for friends and things like that.
And I notice you're extended range now. You've gone 5 strings.
I've gone. And Ian McLagan was so pissed off.
Yes, I was going to ask you. How did you get away with that?
Well, I said, I'm going to compete with your left hand, you little guy. Come on, you're going to go down, way down there. I'm going there too. We had laughs, but he let me get away with it.
That was Ian McLagan and the Bump Band doing Never Say Never. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
Why do you think such prejudice against the 5-string? David, I know David prefers 6-string. We had an interesting conversation with David Swift, and he says, well, really, the 6-string bass is more closer to the electric bass than the upright, because they're both from the guitar family. That was his perspective.
They're very, very, very similar to guitar, yeah. I don't know. I love it all. I mean, a 4-string bass, it kind of condenses your range and scope to a certain parameter, and what I do is kind of shift into that old school mentality where your low notes and you kind of find them in different ways. What I love about the 5-string, it just delivers those big, juicy low C's and B notes. And I mean, stuff that is like really like, wow. I'm careful not to overdo it, but there's moments in a song when nothing like a big old low note to make the point, you know?
That's the bass. Well, it's funny, on my 6-string, I have a D tuner on my low B. So I go down a way. It's great if you're having trouble going to the bathroom.
what I love about the 6-string is that they have that beautiful chordal, I mean, yeah. Which I do a lot on the 5-string, but the 6-string is wonderful that way. It leads you into the treble clef, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And there's something very interesting about, let's say you're on the 3rd fret of the B string, a D. If you go all the way down to the C string 2nd fret, you've just did 2 octaves in one place. So from quote unquote session work, it's great to be able to read because you really don't have to go anywhere and you can really concentrate in a different way.
Good point. Very good point. You know, it's economical.
Exactly.
Right. You can play in the middle of the neck. And of course, it's great for songs in the key of E flat or D.
Correct.
You know?
Yep.
Yeah, that's true, too.
You don't have to get messed up with the D tuner or the whatever that the famous hip shot thing. Now, I was surprised one day I turn on MTV and there's Mark Andes with Heart. Now, I can understand, I guess, your friendship with Heart from Firefall. Probably, is that how you got the gig there?
It probably helped just because there was like a familiarity. Of course, Howie was a Spirit fan back in the day. He's an LA guy. So that had something to do with it. But it's all relationship kind of based. The music business is a lot that way.
Yeah, sure.
And I was working with, after I left Firefall in 80 and moved back to California, was doing a bunch of stuff, was working with Tim Goodman on his project, which was wonderful. And we were in a rehearsal studio and I saw Howard Lee's Heart, you know, and his guitar tech rolling his road cases out of a room. And I went, oh, you know, do you know Howard? And he goes, yeah, I've been Howard's tech for a long time. And Gavin was his name. And I said, would you please give Howard this note? And I wrote a little, hey, Howard, I'm back. I'm back in L.A. What are you doing? Hey, you know, here's my number. And I heard nothing for like 3 months. And then I got a call from him. He called me in the typical Howard Lease deadpan kind of thing. I was like, hey, how would you like to be in Heart? And I went, yeah, that would be good. That could happen. And they said, oh, come on down to the studio. So Nancy and Howie were in Red Line Studios, I think, in Burbank someplace. And I went down there and I thought I would jam with those guys. And Nancy and I sat in this little courtyard and I had my bass and they got a little amp for me. And she said, well, play me something, man. Okay. You know, so, and I do these kind of, they're kind of guitar little oriented things with chords and stuff. Mm-hmm. And I And what I think I did was something like that, kind of a little melodic chordal thing. And she said, okay, fine, thank you. And then I wound up going up to her place in Woodinville, Washington. And that's where there was a jam session with Anne. And that's where I think if there was a real audition, that might have been it. It was Jeff Caffin was the drummer who wound up doing a lot of stuff with Howard later. And we killed it. We killed it. I mean,
it was a great band, yeah.
It was solid and rocking. And then Denny Carmassi wound up becoming available after leaving the Michael Schenker band. He was touring in Europe at that time. And when Denny kind of came into the fold, that's when it really locked in big time. And that was a seriously badass band, man.
I saw that band.
Serious. I mean, in the studio, we killed it. I mean, the guys would get these songs and we would assimilate them and arrange them. And then they would get vetted. And then, of course, the girls would have to go, okay, well, we think this and that. And then the producer would have to have the same input. But basically, the three guys kind of did a lot of work to make that era of Heart really as successful as it was.
That was Heart doing All I Want to Do. This is Notes from an Artist, CygnusRadio.com.
And that was a very interesting point in the music business. We're talking 85, I guess, when it became showbiz and you were on MTV every half hour, every hour. I mean, What About Love was in constant rotation.
Share.
That was another big hit for Hart. That was What About Love? This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
You not only had to play good, Mark, but you had to look good. And you had the faux military jacket and the beautiful tuft of blonde hair like David used to have back in the 80s, I believe.
Well,
my tuft is not so...
It's tough. Your tuft is tough.
My tuft is tough. Yeah, tough. I am.
Oh, man.
It's okay. Well, he beats me up all the time.
I never had a problem dressing up. I mean, Jo Gunne was pretty androgynous. We had some wacky kind of clothes, even though I was only around for a year. And
well, here's David. Here's my fashion cue. See, I'm from the Kaz. Right? See, I never go out of style. This is 50 years ago. This is now. So there you go.
He was
so
ahead of his time. So ahead of his time. But I had no problem dressing up or not dressing down. I don't care. Get me on stage or get me in the studio and it'll be game on, you know.
That was Hart doing Who Will You Run To? This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com. Let's get back to our final 20 minutes with Mark Andes.
It's also a look that complemented the music because you had a big sound, so you had to have a big stage appearance. It's no different than say Broadway. What your dad, the actor, was he around to see those Hart years?
Yeah, he would come on. He would approve. But you're right. There was that production value to the whole thing. The thing is that I think Hart missed the boat, and I don't want to tread on sensitive issues, but you know, when Anne was starting to have a problem with her image, instead of really hiding it and stretching film to embrace it and be like the Cass Elliot,
yes, sure,
or the group that would lead into the marketplace, the grunge movement, to be the mother earth mama of the
right.
From Washington, I think we missed the boat because the girls were, I think, uncomfortable. Obviously, the reaction to it has been to deny and say, oh, we sold out and we did this and that. I had no problem with it, but they did. And I think we missed an opportunity to be really honest and just go, this is who we are, dig it. And how could you go wrong with Anne's vocals? Nice. You would have to, even if we were kind of a hippie band, you know, not the glam band, it would have been maybe more successful.
It's an interesting that you mentioned that, because if you look at your period, Alejandro, Lou Reed, Garland Jeffries, Paul McCartney, Neil Young, Bob Dylan, they all aged gracefully. They didn't try to be young.
Exactly. Yeah. And I was always saying to Trudy Green and Howard Kaufman, I'm saying, what are we doing? Why are we trying to be this glam thing when we're large and in charge over here, you know?
Yeah.
We should embrace that. Sure. Celebrate it.
Fortunate.
Exactly.
Do you think that's part of the business, though, the pressure on women to, you know, someone like Bonnie Raitt, another is an example of someone who doesn't try to be a kid anymore.
Exactly. And she nails it. But she's kept her figure. She's kind of always been kind of a great-looking gal and delivered the goods. The thing about what happened with Hart was I think they tried to not look the way they did and try to compensate some way. My theory is, had we embraced that and said, this is who we are, dig it, you know, and not try to, you know, bustier it up and stretch the film, which we did. But, you know, it was a great experience. I had a lot of fun being a rock star for about a minute or a decade or whatever it was.
Well, it all ties back to Comet. Firefall's being Firefall. We're not trying to be anybody else.
Exactly. There you go. We're here. This is it. You know, we're old, but we can still... The thing about Firefall is that we're still functioning at a pretty high level, even though we're minus our wonderful sax flute guy, David Muse, who's having a health struggle right now. The band is really, really playing its ass off. And I'm proud to play for people that remember the music. I'm proud of it being able to be in a band that can deliver the goods.
When you look back over your career, what are some of the favorite tracks you've recorded with all the bands, with Spirit, with JoJo? We got to put on our playlist there.
Well, Fresh Garbage, of course, is a great song.
Uncle Jack.
Uncle Jack.
Yeah, can't forget that.
Yeah, me singing lead. I mean, go figure. But, you know, Run, Run, Run would be always a favorite. Matt's slide guitar on that. I'm proud of These Dreams.
Oh, that's a great track.
That is a killer song, killer track. And even though I hate Ron Nevison with a passion, I have to share this story. When we cut the track, it was old school. So Nancy sings all of the basic tracks with Howie, Denny, and me. And she's playing acoustic and she's singing, right, as a guide track. And we get this track that we think is, and Peter Wolf, who's the musical director of that song, he's got this program. So we're playing basically to a program, but we kill it. We nail it. And we listen back, and this is one thing I will give Nevison credit for. We're listening back, and he hears Nancy's vocal, and when she cracks, there's a point in the song where she gets this crack in her voice. And he says, oh, she'll want to redo that. But she doesn't know it. But she just sang the lead vocal of this song.
Don't you love that?
And sure as shit, it was the lead vocal. So there's things like that I'm proud of.
Are there any one or two particular performances throughout your career that you hold most fond?
Well, there's the Joe Walsh. We did, I'll tell you what, there was some Sly Stone intervention and some JoJo Gunne tracks.
Really?
He and Freddie were in an adjacent recording studio, and they blew up the amplifier that was helping them record mix their music. They came in and heard us doing, I think we were doing Shake That Fat or something crazy, and they loved it. And that set a wonderful relationship between Sly and the Family Stone and JoJo Gunne.
Wow.
For some reason. And they were partying. They were in their stage clothes. The two of those guys, they were in stage clothes. Wow. With, I mean, feathers. And I mean, I'm talking bright yellow, shiny clothing. And we had so much fun. And they left us a big old, you know, calling card as they left. And
yes.
We played, we played with those guys many a time. And the culmination of that whole little side trip was that when we played opening up for Sly at the...
That's got to be a tough gig, opening for Sly.
Oh, it was, yeah. But we opened up for him and Matt and we're chilling out in the back room, and Sly himself comes in and goes, I want to use your guitar. And Matt goes to Sly, he goes, oh, Sly, yeah, no problem. Freddie can use whatever guitar he wants. I mean, I'll help him pick out whatever he wants. And he goes, no, I want you. I swear to God, man, I have a one little photo of Matt playing shoulder to shoulder with Larry Graham, man. It's the coolest thing. My brother playing with Sly and the Family Stone, man.
Wow.
It was the Cow Palace.
Oh, okay. In San Francisco.
That's his home turf. That was Sly's home turf, man.
Yep.
Wow. You work with some great producers, too. I mean, come on. Lou Adler, David Briggs, you must learn from those guys.
Yep, I sure did.
They really captured the essence of the band on vinyl, which is not an easy thing to do.
Right. Yep. It was kind of an amazing time where, I don't know, when editing was really cutting little pieces of tape.
Right.
And reassembling them. It was a very, very interesting time. Different, whole different time, you know.
Stuff. You can either answer it or not. It's a little provocative.
Oh.
Just say the word Taurus.
Well, I think that Taurus inspired the introduction to Stairway to Heaven. I believe that. I mean, in fact, those guys opened for us and we opened for them enough times. I mean, they were jamming on Fresh Garbage. So they were listening. And, you know, to be honest, I was the guy that was really sort of instrumental in pushing this over the edge. I thought, surely, if we don't do this now, Randy will. And this was after, I mean, this is, you know, several years ago, but Randy was long gone. I mean, I thought, God, if we don't give Randy an opportunity to get credit, it will never happen. Let's pull the trigger. I couldn't actually be the person to bring the suit It wound up being Mick Skidmore. The point is that I think it was a success because Randy was able to tell his story multiple times in the media, his interviews and stuff. And that's all I wanted. I just wanted Randy to get his opportunity. And the fact that, the litigation did not go our way, only because the jury was unable to really hear Spirit's version of Taurus. We heard what they called some weird version of it that actually Dr. Demento compiled just to kind of make the paperwork happen for the publishing and stuff, which was unnecessary actually at the time. The point is that I'm satisfied that Randy got his vetting and people got to hear his story. I had nothing to gain by winning or losing, but yeah.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah.
So that was the Taurus Stairway to Heaven mashup. They're both in the same key. I suggest you draw your own conclusions. This is Notes from an Artist on CygnusRadio.com.
All right, great stuff, Mark. Thanks for talking. Hope to see Firefall in the flesh soon.
Let's do it.
Let's do it, man. And we'll definitely send you links.
You guys, where are you located?
I'm in Connecticut. Tom's in the Bronx.
Okay. The Bronx.
All right. The Bronx.
Riverdale. My wife is looking at me. Riverdale. We live in a nice neighborhood in Riverdale.
Thank you for taking so much of your time. Okay.
Oh, it's great to see you again. And we'll see you live. And when the show airs, we'll give you the links because it's online. So it's ubiquitous. It's archived and it's podcast. And it'll be here long after we're gone. Right.
Yeah, buddy.
All right. Good to see you, Mark. Take care. All the best.
Nice to meet you. Thanks.
All right. Over and out.
So there you have it. That's our show for tonight. And I want to thank my co-host, Tom Semioli, and of course, Mark Andes, for a great interview. And don't forget to check out and purchase the new Firefall recording, Comet. I also wanted to let you know that we are now starting to receive sponsorships. And it is fitting that our first sponsor is DR Strings. Where else would I be able to get pink neon strings for my 6-string bass? They have some of the best strings out there today. Go check them out, DR Strings. I also want to let you know that we are archiving all of our shows via our podcast, also titled Notes from an Artist. You can find these on all the major podcast players or at notesfromanartist.buzzsprout.com. Have a great week. Thanks for listening. This is David Gross with Tom Semioli and Mark Andes. Have a great week.